This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: Old Times, A Picture of Social Life at the End of the 18th Century. Author: John Ashton. Year: 1885. Preface: Of the period of which this book treats, there have been political histories and scurrilous books written anent the royal family, ad nauseam, and the diaries which have been published bearing on this time deal only with the acts and sayings of the higher classes, leaving the life of the vastly greater proportion of the population, the middle classes, untouched. No better source of information as to their mode of living, their amusements, the tattle and passing follies of the times, can possibly be found than in the newspapers of the day, and I selected the commencement of the times, the 1st of January 1788, as the starting point of a picture of the social life at the end of the 18th century. The copies of the times, however, are very imperfect, nay, in some years totally missing, until 1793 to 1794, from which date they are perfect. So that when anything noteworthy occurred, I have drawn from another source, and to establish the undoubted authenticity of each quotation, I have given the title of the newspaper with its date. The daily newspapers of those times were totally different to those to which we are accustomed. The absence of railways, steamships, and electric telegraphs, combined with a very high rate of postage, prevented the publication of all news, either from foreign or provincial sources, except it were of real importance, and as the daily sheets must be filled, it followed as a matter of course that a substitute was found in detailing the social life of the metropolis, and the daily newspapers, which now give us the latest news from all parts of the globe, had to be filled with social paragraphs, anecdotal, satirical, or otherwise. They were as open to correction or contradiction then as now, so that we may put trust in them, and when these paragraphs are collected and somewhat classified, they afford a view of the daily life of the period, such as is utterly unattainable elsewhere. This collection must, of necessity, be valuable to the student of those times, besides being of great interest to the general reader. The difficulty of obtaining contemporary illustrations, fitted for this work, from books or pictures, has compelled me to draw freely on the satirical prints of the period, which are abundant and perfectly well suited to the purpose, if the reader will only bear in mind that they are sometimes a little exaggerated. Still, on the whole, they so truthfully represent the manners, costume, and see of the age that they could not be omitted, and that they are faithful reproductions of the originals, I can guarantee, for I drew them all myself. John Ashton. Topic: Old Times. LD Times. Although this book does not pretend to be a history of the times of which it treats, still, it will materially help the reader if, at the outset, some of the principal events which occurred during the period are succinctly narrated. We start with the year 1788, and one of the first items of importance is the founding of the colony of New South Wales, for Captain Phillips, on the 28th of January, landed the first batch of convicts, consisting of 561 men, 192 women, and 18 children, also a military force of 212 men. As soon as they were all on shore, Phillips ordered the King's Commission to be read, and assumed the office of governor. Such was the modest foundation of our great Australian Empire. On the same day at home, Lord George Gordon, of Protestant rioting memory, was brought before the judges of the King's Bench, to receive sentence on two libels, one against the Queen of France, and another on the criminal justice of the country. His sentence for the former was 3 years' imprisonment, for the latter 2 years, to pay a fine of £500 and find security for his good behavior for 14 years. He fled to Holland, was arrested, brought back, and lodged in Newgate. He did not live to regain his liberty, but death set him free the 1st of November 1793. An all-absorbing topic of conversation in this year was the trial of Warren Hastings for his conduct whilst Governor-General of Bengal. The trial commenced on the 13th of February, and it took place in Westminster Hall, which was fitted up with a throne and canopy, having the woolsack for the Lord Chancellor in front. On either side the throne was a private box, one for the use of the king, the other for the queen. The king never used either throne or box, but when he went to the trial, he went incognito. There were seats covered with green baize for the accommodation of members of the House of Commons, but all the rest of the hall was glowing with red baize. Boxes were also provided for the ambassadors and corps diplomatique. The grand show commenced at 11 a.m. with the entrance of the committee appointed to manage the impeachment, all of them in full dress, followed by Burke, who headed the members of the House of Commons. Hardly had they taken their seats when a buzz of excitement filled the hall, for no one less than the Queen, attended by all her daughters, entered. She did not go to the royal box, but sat in part of the Duke of Newcastle's gallery. This attracted the attention of all until the coming in of the peers, including the judges and the bishops, the string of dukes being closed by the Prince of Wales as Duke of Cornwall, and the Dukes of York, Gloucester, and Cumberland. Lord Thurlow, the Lord Chancellor, came last. The peers all wore their robes and collars, the robes of the royal dukes being borne by pages. Then the Chancellor's mace-bearer cried, "Oyez, oyez, oyez," and notified to all that Warren Hastings had come to take his trial, and that his accusers might come forth and make good their charges against him. The Lord Chancellor addressed the prisoner, and told him to be prepared with his defense, to which Hastings replied, "My lords, I am come to this high tribunal equally impressed with a confidence in my own integrity and in the justice of the court before which I stand. As this trial will not again be mentioned, I may state the fact that it lasted 7 years and 3 months, and ended in his acquittal the 17th of April 1795. Another remarkable event happened in this year, for on the 31st of January there died at Rome, at the age of 67, the young pretender, Prince Charles Edward Louis Casimir Stuart, grandson of James II, and with him died all hope for the Jacobite party, for he left behind him but one natural daughter on whom he conferred the empty title of Duchess of Albany. It is true that he left his pretensions to the throne of England to his brother, Cardinal York, but all this prince did to claim regal honors was to strike a medal, on which he styled himself Henry IX. He knew there was no use in continuing the struggle, so accepted a pension from George III, which was paid him until his death. There is little worth chronicling until we come to the, to Englishmen, most painful event of the year, namely the king's illness. In July his physicians remarked symptoms in him which gave them grave concern, but he visited Cheltenham and improved in his health. In October, however, rumors began to get about that all was not well. The Morning Post of the 30th of October mentions that, "On 28th, His Majesty complained of a pain in his bowels, and by the advice of his physicians and the rest of His Majesty's attendants, he is not expected to leave Windsor for the course of a week or a fortnight. Next day we hear that the chief symptom is said to be a swelling in the legs. Then news is brought that on the 4th of November he had a relapse. On the 7th he is reported better, though, as a matter of fact, he was delirious at dinner on the 5th. On the 9th they say he is better, on the 10th he is much better, and hopes are entertained of his recovery. The bulletins of the 11th are vague, that of the 12th reports that he was not better, and the newspapers of the 13th openly speak of a regency. In the Morning Post of November 14th it plainly states that his mental faculties were more deranged. Then his physicians quarreled amongst themselves as to his treatment, and wrote daily contradictory bulletins, until Dr. Willis took his patient under his sole charge with good effect. And so ends 1788. 1789 opens with a great frost, one of the heaviest on record. It commenced on the 24th of November 1788 and continued, with one intermission, from December 24th to December 26th, until the 13th of January 1789. On the 10th of January, the Thames at Iron Gate, which is below London Bridge by the Tower, was frozen over, and several booths were erected on the ice. The day previously, an ox was roasted whole and eagerly bought by the people who were skating and sliding. The annual register thus describes the sight: "The scene on the Thames is very entertaining, From Putney Bridge upwards, the river is completely frozen over, and people walk to and from the different villages on the face of the deep. Opposite to Windsor Street, booths have been erected since Friday last, and a fair is kept on the river. Multitudes of people are continually passing and repassing. Puppet shows, roundabouts, and all the various amusements of Bartholomew Fair are exhibited. In short, Putney and Fulham, from the morning dawn till the dusk of returning evening, is a scene of festivity and gaiety. On the 12th, a young bear was baited on the ice opposite to Redriff, Rotherhithe, which drew multitudes, and fortunately no accident happened to interrupt their sport. The outward-bound vessels at Deptford and Gravesend cleared out with all dispatch, lest they should be caught in the ice and detained or damaged. The usual royal gift of £1,000 to the poor of London was this year not forthcoming, so the Prince of Wales ordered that sum to be given from his own treasury. He also sent large sums to the poor of Edinburgh and Brighton. A bill to make the Prince of Wales regent had been introduced in both Houses of Parliament at the latter end of 1788, but was negatived in each, in the Commons by 251 to 178. There had been great squabbling over this bill, especially between the rival leaders, Fox and Pitt, the former asserting that the Prince of Wales had an absolute right to succeed to the regency, and the latter would only admit that he had an irresistible claim. But the king did not get better, and something must be done, yet it was not thought fit to invest the Prince of Wales with altogether regal powers. There must be some limitation. Therefore Pitt wrote to His Royal Highness, detailing the plan intended to be pursued, which was, that the Queen should have the care of the King's person, and the disposition of the royal household, by which means she would enjoy the patronage of 400 places, amongst which were the offices of Lord Steward, Lord Chamberlain, and Master of the Horse, but the Prince should have no power of granting any office, reversion, or pension, for any other term than during the King's pleasure, nor might he confer any peerage. This no doubt was prudent, but was extremely distasteful to the Prince, who wrote a dignified remonstrance to Pitt, at the end of which, however, he consented to accept the terms, being convinced of the evils which might arise were there no regency. 55 peers, together with the Dukes of York and Cumberland, signed a protest against the limitations, but the Commons cared but little for it. They went on with their work, and on the 12th of February, sent up the bill to their lordships for consideration. And they were debating it when the proverb of "there's many a slip twixt the cup and the lip" was fulfilled. On the 19th of February, the Lord Chancellor announced to the House that the physicians reported that the King was rapidly recovering from his malady. On this the House adjourned, and practically no work was done either by Lords or Commons for 3 weeks. On the 27th of February, the prayer for his recovery was discontinued, and in its stead a form of prayer, and thanksgiving for his restoration to health, was ordered to be read in all churches and chapels throughout England and Wales. So completely had he recovered, that he ordered Parliament to be opened by commission, which was done on the 10th of March. The 23rd of April was appointed for a general thanksgiving, and His Majesty, accompanied by the Queen and the royal family, went in solemn state to St. Paul's, to render thanks to the Almighty for His great mercy. The following account is much condensed from the report in the Morning Post of the 24th April 1789. They started early, for, precisely at 8 o'clock in the morning, the first carriage that led the procession reached St. Clement's Church in the Strand. After the usual state pioneers came the members of the House of Commons, followed by the peers according to their several degrees, then the archbishops, and the princes of the blood royal, after whom came the Prince of Wales, whose equipage outshone all others. Their Majesties' household came next, and lastly their Majesties themselves. The Queen seemed inexpressibly happy. The loud huzzas, which from every quarter rent the air, testified to her that he who was dearest to her was dearest to the people. The King, as if impressed by the weight of the obligation which he owed to heaven for his recovery, and full of the religious solemnity with which he was going publicly to acknowledge that obligation to the Almighty, seemed to be unusually grave and silent, and behaved at this first appearance in public since his recovery in a manner which filled the spectators with reverence and awe. His Majesty appeared to be much reduced in point of size, but he looked as if in perfect health. It was 3:15 when the procession, on its return, reached Temple Bar, and it was noted that the King looked more cheerful whilst the Queen was in high spirits. London was, of course, brilliantly illuminated at night. This is the principal event of the year, and with it we will close 1789. As far as England and its social economy is concerned, 1790 is very barren. In France, there was the commencement of that dreadful revolution which terrorized all Europe, yet strangely enough, all allusion to France was omitted in the royal speeches to Parliament, either on the 21st of January or the 26th of November. The Navy sadly wanted manning, so much so that a proclamation was issued for encouraging seamen and landsmen to enter themselves on board His Majesty's ships of war, that officers on foreign stations should join their respective corps, and recalling and prohibiting seamen from serving foreign princes and states. This was all very well, for the fleet was in urgent need of men, owing to the number of ships being put in commission, and ordered to be got ready for sea with the greatest expedition, for instance. At Deptford 3, Woolwich 3, Chatham 3, Sheerness 3, Portsmouth 10, 1,100 and another 98 guns, Plymouth 7, 1,100 another 80 guns, besides others, which were expected to be commissioned in a few days. Ordinary means were not sufficient to provide men, and resort was made to impressment, a mode of obtaining seamen which is of ancient practice. In 1378, a statute of 2 Richard II speaks of it as being well known, and so it must have been, for the first commission for its use was issued 29 Edward III, 1355. In 1641, Parliament declared the practice illegal either for the land or sea service, but this has always been ignored when the necessity for seamen arose. It has been regulated by Parliament even so lately as 1835, when, by the Statute 5 and 6 William IV, compulsory service is restricted to 5 years. How should we feel if some day, in reading our morning paper, we should come across such a passage as the following? A very hot press took place in the River Thames and at all the outports. Would you like to know what a hot press means? Then learn from the following excerpts from the St. James's Chronicle, May 4-6, 1790. The report of the number pressed in the river on Tuesday night was delivered to the Lords of the Admiralty yesterday morning, which amounted to about 1,500 taken in Wapping, and in Southwark in Sea, more than 600, amounting in the whole to upwards of 2,100 men, besides those at the different seaport towns, reports of which were not received. 4 tenders went down the river yesterday morning, crowded with impressed men, to be shipped on board a vessel of war lying in long reach, ready to receive them. The same tenders were expected up again, with the return of the tide, upon the same errand. Extract of a letter from Chatham, May 5. Yesterday morning between 6 and 7 o'clock, an express arrived from the Lords of the Admiralty to Commodore Pasley at this port, containing impress warrants. Accordingly, a great press commenced about 12 o'clock last night, both in this town, Rochester, in sea, and on the River Medway, when many persons were taken, 4 of whom were lodged in the guardhouse in the yard, and this morning sent on board the Scipio of 64 guns, lying as guardship at this port, and commanded by Commodore Pasley. A great press likewise commenced last night at Sheerness. In consequence of the press warrants, stocks felt a most extraordinary depression yesterday. The consols opened at 76 and fluctuated from that price to 75 minus 1/4 until very nearly 3 o'clock. This then was a hot press, but very little was ever said about it except a passing notice. The impressed men themselves accepted their fate as inevitable, and according to the testimony of an old seaman whom I once knew, himself a pressed man, he assured me that, after the first shock was over, they set to work with a will and did their duty as well as the volunteers. There were supposed to be exceptions, such as apprentices, who were exempt. But I fear, when once in the hands of the press gang, it was a very poor chance of anyone's getting off. A social note worthy of being recorded in this year was that a man named John Frith, lieutenant of the 2nd Battalion of Royals, threw a stone at His Majesty's coach. He seems to have done no harm, and was evidently a lunatic, for no one in their senses would have endeavored to injure a king who was just then in the zenith of his popularity. That he was insane, the jury thought, for on his trial for high treason on the 21st of May, he was acquitted as being of unsound mind, but he was put under safe watch and ward in Newgate, and only liberated on the 11th of December 1791, on bail being given to take proper care of him. The year 1791 is remarkable for its uneventfulness, nothing of national importance occurring during the 12-month. Impressment still went on, as we see by the St. James's Chronicle, April 16 to 19. Friday night the press in the Thames, and on both sides the river, was the warmest that has been at all since press warrants were last issued. No fewer than 11 galleys were rowing about between London Bridge and Deptford. Every one of His Majesty's frigates and sloops on channel service, as well as those in the North Sea and on the Irish coast, have received orders to proceed upon the impress service. The smaller vessels, as soon as they have procured 40 seamen each, are to deliver them over to the receiving ships at Spithead and the Nore. In 1787 a society was formed in England, having for its object the suppression of slavery, under the auspices of Granville Sharp, Clarkson and others, and Mr. Wilberforce, by whose untiring efforts its downfall was at last obtained, joined it. On the 18th of April 1791, the House of Commons resolved itself into a committee to consider of the African slave trade. Wilberforce made an eloquent speech, in which he depicted the horrors of the trade. Among other barbarities, he mentioned the whipping and holding red-hot coals to the mouths of those in order to compel them to eat, who were desirous of putting an end to their existence by starving themselves to death, and to prove the preference given by those unhappy creatures of death to slavery. He quoted part of the evidence, which told how they took every opportunity of leaping overboard, and that, in the agonies of death, when drowning, they would hold up their hands for joy in having escaped from their tormentors. He mentioned many cruelties which had passed unpunished, and particularly one which was committed by a master upon his female slave, a girl about 6 years old, by cutting her mouth from ear to ear. He showed how injurious the slave trade was to our mercantile navy, quoting from the muster rolls of Liverpool and Bristol that in 1 year, out of 12,263 seamen employed in the slave trade, 2,643 had died. After many other arguments, he concluded with a motion that the chairman be directed to move for leave to bring in a bill for preventing the further importation of African Negroes into the British colonies and plantations. The debate was continued and adjourned until the next day, when the battle pro-slavery or its abolition waxed fierce. But when it came to a decision, the numbers were for the motion 88, against 163, majority against the abolition 75. 1792 opened, as we would fain have our financial years open nowadays, with an increase of revenue over the preceding year of £300,000, and a surplus of more than £900,000, besides paying the annual million in reduction of the national debt. Pitt repealed £200,000 of burdensome taxes, added £400,000 to the million to extinguish the debt, and discreetly kept the balance in hand for eventualities. Trade had vastly increased, as we may see from the following figures. In 1783, the exports were valued at £14,741,000, and in 1791, they had risen to £20,120,000. On the 2nd of April, the House of Commons being in committee, Mr. Wilberforce again brought forward the question of the slave trade, and after an eloquent speech, wound up with the motion that it is the opinion of the committee that the trade carried on by British subjects for the purpose of procuring slaves from Africa ought to be abolished. After a debate, Mr. Secretary Dundas moved as an amendment to insert the word gradually immediately before the word abolished. This was carried by a majority of 68, and the motion so altered being put, the numbers were ayes 230, noes, 85, majority for the motion, 145. The chairman was then ordered to move the House for leave to bring in a bill, pursuant to the said resolution. England could not but be affected by the French Revolution. At the commencement of the movement, there was some sympathy shown by the Whigs to a people who were struggling to free themselves from the trammels of despotism. But that sympathy rapidly grew cold and faded on witnessing the excesses committed by the people of Paris and some other large cities, until the capture and imprisonment of the royal family turned it to absolute loathing and hatred. There was great uneasiness throughout the country as to whether the tide of anarchy might not reach us, especially as numbers of fugitives were daily reaching our shores. Take, for example, two instances quoted in the Annual Register, both of the date the 12th of September. Southampton. One Ayland, a fisherman of Hamble, a village about 7 miles from Southampton, was fishing for lobsters on the coast of France on Thursday last, and had taken in about half his cargo when he espied two boats full of men seemingly in great distress, on which he bore down and received them on board. They had swam to their boats to get away from the coast, and many of them were much bruised and pelted with stones by others on shore. They begged the fishermen to land them somewhere in England, to prevent their being murdered, which he promised to do, and offered them subsistence till he had completed his lading. They represented the danger of being intercepted if he did not immediately proceed to sea, and offered him any sum he should ask, to land them as soon as possible. He waived his own interest, set sail, and landed them at the above village, but with a spirit of humanity which does honor to human nature, he absolutely refused any reward whatever, although he had not completed his fishing, which is the maintenance of his family. Lewis. Upwards of 500 unfortunate emigrants were, last week, landed on our coast, who have had the fury of the elements to contend with after escaping that of their countrymen. The Brighton packets, heavily laden with them, were driven by the winds far eastward off their usual track, and with difficulty made Hastings, Pevensey, and Eastbourne. At the former place, on Wednesday morning, 76 all ecclesiastics came on shore, among whom were the Bishop of Avranches, the Dean of Rouen, and several other dignitaries. The bishop with great difficulty escaped from Avranches by the assistance of one of his grand vicars, who, with domestics, accompanied him to Rouen, where they were for some days concealed. The populace having again discovered them, they were again obliged to travel on foot in disguise to Dieppe. They arrived in the night, took refuge a few hours in an hotel, and at the time appointed for the departure of the packet, ran to the seaside, and it providentially being high water, were enabled to get out of reach of the rabble, who in 1 minute after pursued them to the shore. Take again an extract or two from the St. James's Chronicle of 11-13 of September 1792. Between daybreak and 8 o'clock yesterday morning, 13 broad-wheeled wagons crowded with French emigrants passed through the borough. During the night, and the whole of yesterday forenoon, wagons, carts, and chaises, and carriages of almost every other description, continued arriving in town with emigrants by way of Westminster, Blackfriars, and London Bridges. It is a known fact that upwards of 40,000 French men, women, and children are at this moment in England, two-thirds of them of the lowest class, who, taking advantage of the convulsed state of their native country, come over under the plausible title of exiled aristocrats. There are three powerful reasons why the very great number of arrivals here from France should excite the immediate attention of government. 1. That it may occasion a rapid rise in the price of provisions, already at a height that occasions much complaint among the lower orders of people. 2. Lest, under the appellation of fugitives, a multitude of insidious and evil-designing persons should intrude themselves, with the intention of raising similar disturbances in this kingdom. 3. Lest it should be the means of introducing a great number of rascals, thieves, and villains, who are always cowards and cannot have principle enough to take any side. These, therefore, are the first to run. An inundation of them, added to the bad among our own people, might not only render private property very precarious, but even prove dangerous to the state. The government was fully alive to this great influx of Frenchmen and the possible effect it might have on the people of England. So they introduced and passed the Act for establishing regulations respecting aliens arriving in this kingdom. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.